Superspeed, the superpower that allows you to move in slow motion, do anything in seconds, and outrun time itself. But it comes at a cost. Several of them. Today we're gonna look at speedsters to figure out what would happen if you one day acquire their powers. How would these work if instead of being nerfed by the plot and explained with
the speed force,
it was real life physics and your own anatomy doing the dirty work? Well, there's only one way to find out. So let me set the scene. It's Sunday, and you woke up to realize that you can move, think, and run at superhuman speeds. Question is, what are you doing first? For those who said reaching light speed or going back in time, pretending you have a flux capacitor up your ass,
this is what makes time travel possible. The flux capacitor.
Just wait. We'll get there eventually. But for now, let's assume your first day went a bit slower. After what for some reason seemed to be the most lackluster breakfast of your life, you decide to go for a jog. At Mach 1. Bad idea? Let's see. The first issue you'd face would be acceleration, the super type. Thanks to a video made on Superspeed by Because Science years ago, we know that going fast, very fastly, could lead to hand ripping and leg breaking disasters.
Snap! Oh!
Good news is, supersonic jets exist. These bad boys can get up to well over 2,500 miles an hour by gradually increasing their velocity. That's over 3 times the speed of sound. So although not light speed, at least the speed of sound should be safe. But doesn't reaching the speed of sound create a sonic? Yes, and its power is enough to shake the ground, break windows, and deafen people near you. However, for the sake of this video, and the fact that half of you couldn't care less about windows breaking, we're gonna let that one slide. Now, where were we? Oh, right. The existence of these jets means that as long as you don't go from 0 to Mach 1 in an instant, you take your time with braking, and you train as hard as an F1 driver,
I am stupid.
You should be able to take the G-forces while going in a straight line. But what if you want to turn? Towards the sub button. Please subscribe. Thanks. Have you ever been on a highway and tried to make a 90 degree turn at 60 miles an hour? No? Okay, well don't. Because you will either lose control or you'll... Trust me, you don't want that to happen while you're running. And if it isn't the momentum that sends you flying, then it'll be the friction that screws you over. Because if F1 drivers lose control at 100 miles an hour using tires designed for grip, your Nike Air Force Ones made for walking, and every other shoe if you're wondering, will have trouble keeping you stuck to the ground at 3 times the speed of sound. So, you either find a way to generate a crap ton of downforce, or you simply slow down to prevent your bones from snapping. That's not too bad, is it? No. But now imagine making those turns blind. If there's something Quicksilver and Kid Flash got right, it was wearing protection. Wait, what? When running at supersonic speeds, you would be hitting winds and bugs at extremely high speeds that are sure to mess up your vision. So wearing goggles and some sort of armor is not a bad idea. However, that's not the only thing I meant by going blind.
I'm sorry, are you talking to me?
Whenever you're moving at high speeds, things relatively close to you tend to get blurry, which is why the faster you go, the worse this effect gets. Because Science also talks about this and makes an example with a real animal who suffers from the same problem. Go check it out if you want to get into the details. But essentially, he concludes that to process the amount of information going through your eyes and into your brain, you would need a second power that is arguably just as cool as super speed itself. Remember this scene? Or this one? Or maybe this one? The only reason the speedster is able to see the world clearly and manipulate the elements around him is simply because his brain is able to take all of the information and process it at
ludicrous speed!
And this power is superhuman perception. The cool thing about this power is that it not only prevents you from becoming wall tortilla every time you run, but it also allows you to dodge bullets and have, allegedly, enhanced reflexes. Since now it's not only your limbs that can move fast, but also your brain.
You can't see things how I do. My perception is just as fast as I am. The briefest conversation with anyone seems like hours to me. It's agony!
We've got a problem. If we assume that your superhuman perception allows you to slow down your surroundings while you're moving at supersonic speeds, what happens when you're not? Speedsters can usually toggle this perception on and off at will, allowing them to experience time normally. But what if you couldn't? This would mean that no matter what, every conversation would feel like hours have passed. Nothing would scare or surprise you anymore. And you would feel like you've lived 10 times longer than you did. Wait, what's that? What? The thing about living longer. What about it? I have a theory. Ignore comic book logic for a second and ask yourself, what if your brain wasn't the only organ that adapted to your speed, and your other organs and tissue also got hit with the slowness effect? Would they work at the usual speed, or would they instead decay and or heal faster, leading to an alteration in your lifespan? Leave your thoughts in the comments. Crazy theory, right? But you know what isn't a theory though? Energy. The chemical type. Remember that lackluster breakfast you had earlier? Surprisingly enough, it wasn't due to your poor cooking skills, but rather your stomach asking for rent. You see, the average male burns around 500 calories after running about 4 miles or 6.5 kilometers. And when running at the speed of sound, this number looks scary high. But is it really? Picture this. The distance from Boston to San Francisco is around 3,000 miles, and according to the math, you could make a one-way trip in little less than 4 hours while losing a total of 375,000 calories. And considering the daily recommended calorie intake is about 3,000 calories and that the average human isn't born with enough stamina to run for 3,000 miles, then you'd probably faint before reaching New York. However, that's a pretty long trip. What about a shorter one? Trips of around 50 miles or less would only burn around 6,250 calories, which is a daily calorie goal you could easily reach thanks to your enhanced metabolism. On top of that, a 50-mile radius is enough to cover the entirety of New York, and you'd take 4 minutes at most to reach even the furthest points, meaning any shorter distance than that shouldn't take much of a toll on your body. But what if you wanted to go faster? What if you were bored of going supersonic, and you one day decided to reach light speed? Oh, cool. Wait, did I say cool? Oh, my bad, I meant hot. Like, extremely hot. Have you ever seen how things entering Earth at insane speeds tend to burn up? Well, now imagine this is you, but like, 1,000 times hotter. There's 2 theories that explore this problem. The first one is proposed by Because Science. And he says that although friction ignites these iconic flames, it is adiabatic compression, adiabatic meaning no air can leave the system, what's gonna be responsible for cooking you alive. Why? Well, because the air pressure created right in front of you when you run at about 300 million meters per second can't leave the system. Therefore, it generates enough heat to melt you in place. But hey, maybe the other theory isn't that bad, right? I mean, if you consider that blowing up Earth is not that bad, then sure. MathPat from Film Theory mentions the Coulomb barrier, which is a physics concept that explains how atoms cannot achieve fusion under normal circumstances. Unless you add a little speed. Extreme speeds of more than 44 million miles per hour are enough to break the Coulomb barrier. And since light speed is 15 times faster than that, then only one question remains. What does breaking the Coulomb barrier mean? Then again, if you want the numbers, go check MathPat's video. But he essentially explains how millions of tiny fusion reactions would occur non-stop when air molecules pile up in front of you, generating heats of around 5 billion degrees. Which translated to caveman means atoms go big boom. Like football field type of big. So Does this mean that you couldn't hit light speed? What about traveling back in time and doing some funny stuff back there?
Seems safe and
breathable.
What about phasing through objects, running on water, or throwing lightning bolts at people? All of these are famous side effects that usually come included with ludicrous levels of speed. But they're just too much of a stretch if you want to go beyond the safe levels of supersonic speed. And here's why. To be fair, running on water doesn't seem as crazy, since there's already animals capable of doing so thanks to their anatomy. However, if you're planning on somehow manipulating the quantum state of your particles in order to go through solid brick, wouldn't you just fall through the floor? I mean, I guess you could do a well-timed jump, though. And talking about timing, what if the key to time travel isn't going extremely fast, but instead just reaching a specific speed? I don't know. I just wish there was a way to protect you from all of the disadvantages I've mentioned so far. Speed Force. Wait, what is that? Let me just... Okay, found it. Well, it says here that the Speed Force is an energy field that gives speedsters the abilities I've mentioned earlier, and it protects him or her from practically everything I've said in this video. Oh, shit. And if you want to know what you wouldn't want Spider-Man powers either, click this video next. And as always, thanks for watching.